Good Shabbos, Shabbat Shalom, everyone. The parsha this week is Chaya Sara, and it shows a romanticized version of matchmaking. The artistic vision of Sarah and Abraham's relationship at the time of Sarah's death does not match the reality of their very human relationship. Rather, it paints an aspirational, rosy picture of things as an ideal. Why is the imaginative, artistic, and romanticized ideal of reality so prevalent in our consciousness? Why do we choose to remember our great patriarch and our great matriarch with saintly reverence? What is it about art that can seemingly outweigh reality? How is it that art can shatter our reality? Why art? Why convey messages with our imagination? Why depart from reality itself? Just speak the truth, one may wonder. This is the question that I would like to focus on and that I share with you today. The answer to this question has informed my rabbinate. The intersection of art and Judaism is ingrained into my neshama. As a child, I learned from my father how to paint, carve, and draw, and I embarked upon my first art exhibition at the age of 13. At the same time, I grew up with a more traditional set of Jewish observances and practices. Art always seemed as a powerful liberation tool from some of the more regimented and challenging confines of life. Entering college at American University in Washington, D.C., I was introduced to a more diverse picture of Judaism, and I eventually entered into the progressive movements. I completed an M.A. in Holocaust and Genocide Studies and an M.A. in Jewish Studies from Graz College, in which I focused on the intersectionality of artistic cinema as a conduit for confronting anti-Semitism during the height of fascism in the 1930s. Art is the color through which I see my world. It is empowering, it is subversive and analytical, it is commentary, it has been used by our people to overthrow dictators, to challenge anti-Semitism, and to wage wars on Hitler and Stalin. It has ushered in new eras, and it has been a constant pulse of the people and for the people. It is a democratic voice in which all can participate in, regardless of background, national origin, or religion. Art has the ability to create equality, and it sounds the eternal voices of our people. It is a naturally liberating force. A case in point was Arthur Zick, who championed the subversive art of the brushstroke to offer political, social, and religious commentaries from the 1920s until the 1940s. A Polish-born Jew, Zick's artwork defines a subversive culture against Bolshevism and fascism. His art form laid the groundwork for the political satires that would characterize Mad Magazine's political commentaries. His Passover Haggadah satirized Mussolini, Hitler, and Hirohito, and it took swipes at the classical Jewish establishment norms. To borrow a word from the Holocaust and Humanity Center of Cincinnati, he was an upstander for Jewish women. His Haggadah included Miriam's Cup, and his artwork commented upon the women's suffrage movement in America. Brushstrokes are not the only way to empower the powerless. No greater force could dominate the hearts and souls of the masses in the 20th century other than film. Consider the talent that goes into every film production. From the writers to the cinematographers and actors, the industry has historically had a healthy Jewish presence. Edgy commentaries from the 1930s and the 1940s particularly spoke to a moment of immense powerlessness in our history. Scripts like The Mad Dog of Europe, To Be or Not to Be, Mortal Storm, The Great Dictator, and the Three Stooges shorts, You Nazi Spy and I'll Never Howl Again, all strip dictators and demagogues naked. The commentaries were not only subversive because they castigated Germany as an enemy, they were subversive on a more local level in America because of the political censorship felt during the Breen and Hayes era of the motion picture industry. Some films were simply too edgy for their time. It Can't Happen Here, a theatrical adaptation of Sinclair Lewis's book, was so heavily censored that it was only recently picked up again by production studios. Music, dance, and poetry also give voices to people and empower the powerless. Each offers a promise of equanimity and a voice for the oppressed and the disenfranchised. I am reminded of Paul Robeson's impressive and provocative performance of Zsolnay Kamel in Moscow during 1949 at the height of Stalin's purges. Although not Jewish, a Christian-born African-American, Paul Robeson used the Mamaloyshin to stand with the Jewish people. Robeson led an entire life of subversion and was blacklisted from the United States during the McCarthy era. Although he never publicly acknowledged it, his performance in Moscow was a swipe at Soviet leadership for its purge against the Jewish people. A model of this subversive artist, nothing was unintentional for Robeson. His performance in Moscow was an act of artistic dissent. The great subversive generation of the 1960s and the 1970s likewise used music as a vehicle for change and as an opportunity to tune out during an unpopular chapter of American politics. Figures like Bob Dylan commanded a following unlike anything seen in music scenes today. His music, which could hardly be called popular because of his voice, remains American poetry. The movement he became a part of was a widespread liberation of thinking, namely challenging the status quo, systemic racism, pervasive attitudes of anti-Semitism, and a generally decrepit old world order of thinking. Timeliness and relevance are part of all successful artistic endeavors. They must speak to what people feel and align with people's pulse. They must be the voice of the people and something people can connect with and feel in their kishkas. For someone to put their heart and soul into something, it must fundamentally offer them hope over despair. One person who lived this was an individual I met as part of my first units of clinical pastoral education as I worked in one of Cincinnati's hospitals as a chaplain. One day I entered into the room of an elderly man. I expected to serve him spiritually that day, but he delivered a story that emboldened my theology. I immediately knew from his name and from his self-designated religious affiliation that he was a Russian Jew, an immigrant from the former Soviet Union. He spoke no English, so the spiritual counseling was offered in Russian. I asked him about his life, his family, and speaking with him in his language offered an opportunity to finally talk with someone after several days in the hospital. He was a Holocaust survivor and an artist. Although he did not talk about it, he had tattoos on his arm and on his fingers. I recognized the tattoos. Growing up as a Russian-American Jew in Philadelphia, I had grown used to seeing the tattoos on his hand, his arm, and on his knuckles. They were the tattoos belonging to Russian crime syndicates, and the tattoo on his arm was from a Russian gulag. A spiritual person, his artwork had always been faith-based, including stained glass windows, woodworking, and iconography. Fundamentally, this made him a criminal in the Soviet Union. He was only able to pursue a life of legality in America after the collapse of the Soviet Union. This individual was the closest I would get to the Jewish artisans who were connected to pre-war Europe. His story brought to life the challenges he faced as an artist from the Nazi to the Soviet period. He could only live the life he wanted to here in America. And he used art as a subversive tool. Even though the Soviets put him into a gulag, his art continued and his message persevered. His story is but a grain of sand in an ocean of similar stories of Jewish craftspeople from the former Soviet Union. The great irony of tragedy is that one set of catastrophes, the Holocaust and the oppression of Soviet Jewry, nearly wiped out the art of Jewish woodworking, but it is being revived during another catastrophe, during COVID-19. During my time here at Hebrew Union College Jewish Institute of Religion's rabbinical program, I embarked upon the Opening the Ark project. The project began as part of my capstone project earlier this year, but it has now grown into its own nonprofit 501c3. For those unfamiliar with it, the Opening the Ark Project of Cincinnati is currently involved in reconstructing one of the great wooden arks of the Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth. The ark undergoing reconstruction was among the jewels of European Jewry. Towering and coated in vibrant colors, it stood in Sidra, Poland, but it was destroyed by the Nazis in 1942. With Polish, Sephardic, Ashkenazi, and Russian influences, it testified to a Jewish dialogue and to the Jewish mastery of art, artistry, and carpentry. The current project responds to some dilemmas affecting Jewish life in America today, and it will redefine how many engage with Judaism and with Holocaust education. The reconstruction effort is an open canvas for people who wish to try to find a new relationship with Judaism. Regarding engagement, this project reaches inside and potentially outside of our Jewish community, and it involves people in new ways. It is compelling because in a world that can often seem challenging and even disheartening, the project continues to provide hope and empowerment. It can liberate us from the trials and tribulations we face today, and it can lift us up. The cohort of artisans involved with the project have found the project a healthy escape from the confines of COVID-19. Under the circumstances of a pre-COVID-19 world, much of their contributions may have been impossible. From the skilled workers, the structural engineers, to the architects, most have been laid off and have chosen to volunteer their time to a 501c3 for government benefits. Today, I have a volunteer coordinator and a team of artists and volunteers lining up to volunteer their time throughout every week. This has helped for people to reimagine Holocaust education as an experience of personal investment. With a line out the door of painters, woodcrafters, architects, and engineers, Holocaust education has reached a new level, and the art itself is helping uplift the artists' souls. Yet woodworking also liberates the Jewish soul from a nasty postmodern stereotype that Jews are not particularly handy or versatile with tools. Reclaiming our rightful place as competent, skilled workers is nothing to be ashamed of. Imagine ourselves as the new Jew, empowered with power and hand tools. The language of empowerment via hand and power tools is something that groups like Women's Workshop of Richmond, Indiana, have adopted to empower disenfranchised groups, namely women and women of color, to feel a sense of ownership in a heavily male-dominated profession. For the great majority of Jews interested in volunteering for the project, men and women alike, this was their first opportunity to operate hand and power tools. Using these tools for the first time is a powerful act. Still, this holy enactment is a powerful and subversive narrative that conflicts with the overwhelming majority of Holocaust and Soviet Jewish education. I am a third-generation survivor, and it is time to shift the narrative in Holocaust and Soviet Jewish education. Too often, the post-Holocaust and post-Soviet narratives have been commandeered by a narrative of immeasurable and inconceivable loss and death. The result scares away the vast majority of people. People who remain attentive either cannot comprehend the death of 1, 2, or 3, let alone 6 million people, or they are so depressed at the end that they are traumatized. The project redefines this education by rebuilding something of ritual significance as a method of understanding and comprehending loss. Engaging in woodworking preserves the memory and tradition of our craftspeople, a craft the Holocaust and the Soviet Union sought to destroy lives on in ourselves because we are part of that history. The post-Holocaust narrative needs to shift from our destruction and move to our rebirth. This is where my project fits in. It is an enactment of a pervasive spiritual and artistic liberation. It is a redefining of our Holocaust and Soviet narratives. I will not let this art form's flame become extinguished under my watch. It will be passed on to the next generation. Today, we need art more than ever before. Right now, with a major election behind us, many of us are feeling the fabric of our democracy feels as though it is falling apart beneath us, and that the will of the people may yet be subdued. With the legitimacy of a free election being called into question, democracy itself feels as though it is being challenged. To which we may imagine from our collective consciousness, it can't happen here. But we know better. It can. It can happen here. We have long battled tyranny and totalitarian regimes that have enacted similar measure to their political process. My family escaped such a system in the Soviet Union, and we need art because it offers us a stable voice in this unstable world. Art can continue to give us the expression of power we need to feel human again. And as we have learned in our history, humans are mortal, ideals are not. Ideals may be immortalized in art, ideals like the romanticized vision of Sarah in our Parshat HaShavua outweigh their broken reality. It creates literary function for our stories and creates heroes and characters of saintly reverence. We need them today as we need art today. And although the voice of such a person who carries a message, such as Paul Robeson, or an entire people, such as women or the Jewish people, may be repressed, the floodgates may only delay the eventual outpour of the great masses of an ideal, of good over evil, of progress over delay, of love over hate, of all our voices. The all-encompassing definition of creative arts, stories, music, dance, painting, or woodworking will carry our messages transcending generations and telling the story of the vitality of our people throughout this challenging time into the future. Our future is bright. Artistic and creative innovation will continue to propel our people and empower to liberate ourselves into the future. As Charlie Chaplin once said, the misery that is now upon us is but the passing of greed, the bitterness of men who fear the way of human progress. But the hate of men will pass, and the power taken from the people will one day, soon, return to the people, and liberty will never perish. This message of liberation and empowerment is the core to my rabbinate. It is a story that began with my childhood and blossomed with my experiences and studies. And through the experience of training as a rabbi at HUC, it has come to fruition. Using art as a Jewish medium to reach for the future, let us look with optimism as we build a brighter tomorrow. Ken Yehi Ratzon.